What's up, guys? Flamictini here, and I am back for my Week 5 SPL game. I'm going to be playing against Elkans, who is on the classiest, and he is going to be using a hard offense team featuring Pharamosa and Mega Metagross, two staple offensive mons. He's also got a Greninja, which, looking to me, looks like it could possibly be Ash Greninja, but it could also very much likely be the Protean set, which a lot more people have been gravitating towards lately. He's also got a Rotom Wash as well as a Magearna, so I'm not really sure if the Magearna is a Salt Vest or not. He kind of really appreciates the Salt Vest. Well, any team really can appreciate, any offense team can appreciate a Salt Vest because of its insane bulk, but because he's got Rotom as a bulky pivot as well, I'm not entirely sure if that Magearna is certainly a Salt Vest, but it could be. And he's got a Lando for rocks, and depending on his set, the Lando could be a Z-move rocker potentially, or he could have the Z-move on Pharamosa, or maybe on Magearna, or not at all. So we'll see how it goes. Looking at my team, I've got a Charizard Y, which he has zero switch-ins to, and it can 1v1. Most importantly, it can take on that, it can check that Pharamosa, it can take one hit from that Metagross, it should be able to take one hit from Greninja and KO back. Basically, Charizard White can pretty much 1v1 the vast majority of his team, and because it pretty much, the really only way he can get it, kind of like prevent losing to Charizard Y, is to just continuously pressure with it, because my Charizard does need to be healthy to 1v1 everything. So I'm knowing that, I'm just going to lead off with my Zard Y, knowing I can most likely just pick up a kill straight from the first turn or first two turns. He leads off with this Pharamosa and just goes for the U-turn. Now, looking at this U-turn damage, I can actually tell that this thing is most likely is max attack and adamant, well, plus attack nature, so I'm pretty sure certain that it's a Scarf Pharamosa. He definitely does appreciate the speed for revenge killing. I just go straight for a Fire Blast, and as you see, that completely toasts the Rotom right there. I could have gone for a second Fire Blast and KO'd, but I didn't think it was worth risking the miss at all, and he kind of just doesn't have the freedom to try to predict a Solar Beam, just because Fire Blast will kill as well, and if I go for that and he tries to switch to, like, Metagross or something like that, it just won't work out. So I just go for a Solar Beam safely to take him out. He's gonna go into his Metagross. That chip is actually a little bit enough to make me want to switch, so I go to my Ferrothorn, and he actually pulls a double switch into his Magearna. This play right here was kind of nice for Elkans for two different reasons. Well, one, it just puts the pressure on my Ferrothorn. My Ferrothorn is really key to keeping his Metagross down, because a lot of them are not carrying Hammer Arm in favor of Earthquake, so my Ferrothorn can check it, and if he does have Hammer Arm, that makes it easier for my other mons to check it. For example, Zard Y can grab another kill right there. And also for that Greninja, especially a, well, it depends on the Greninja set. I do have Tentacruel, which takes on almost every single Greninja, but Tentacruel is also given the task of checking Pharamosa, potentially checking Magearna, so it can get worn down in this game. And so I do want to keep my Ferrothorn healthy, basically. I definitely want to keep my Lando healthy, because that helps me play around Scarf Pharamosa a lot. Helps me play around his Landorus extremely importantly, especially if he's in an offensive set. And to an extent, the Metagross as well. So I don't want to just stay in with the Ferrothorn and take, like, a Focus Blast. Or since the sun is up, he could also be HP Fire. I really don't want to take an HP Fire to the face in the sun. So I pull a switch to Tentacruel. I think this was a mistake. If you look at my matchup, I really kind of appreciate Tentacruel's health, Zard, Lando, Ferrothorn, and Pharamosa. Whereas Tapu Koko, it's nice, but I don't really need it for anything. And a fully healthy Tentacruel is way, way better than a damaged Tentacruel in this matchup. Now that Tentacruel is at 50% health, it can't really switch into stuff as easily like Greninja or Pharamosa. And so that creates a lot of trouble for me later on in the game when I'm trying to spin and get off rocks for Zard so that Zard can check things and get kills. So yeah, I think this Volt Switch was a nice play by Elkans, and it's kind of awkward for my Tentacruel, especially since he goes to his Lando right here, and Sun is up. I'm actually a fast Tentacruel, so I would have been able to potentially Oko, or actually, I don't think I can Oko. I don't have Ice Beam, but I could, like, Hydro Pump would be able to do a ton of damage or possibly even KO depending on his set, and I would definitely be able to outrun since it's not going to be Scarf Lando. But the sun is up for one more turn, so it's really awkward that I have to switch my Tentacruel out versus Lando when it's fast so that it can threaten Lando, and also that like I take that Volt Switch damage. So I think definitely going to Tapu Koko instead of Tentacruel. It still gives him the Lando and the rocks, and I can't. It's also awkward because I can't go to Zard on this turn and lose the sun because then I don't have the threat of Okoing Lando. So yeah, it's kind of awkward for me that position. So that's why the Volt Switch was really nice with this, with regards to the sun turns and getting the damage and stuff. So I just go to my Lando. I think this was actually a little bit risky because if you look, now that I've taken that damage with Tentacruel, his Faramosa becomes much more threatening with a possible HJK sweep, especially since rocks are now up on Zard. So basically that leaves my only checks as Tapu Koko and Lando. So if I took an HP Ice here, that would have been really, really tough for me. It would have been annoying for me, definitely. Now he actually goes for U-turn and goes to his Greninja. I think I should have realized that this was most likely indicated that this Lando did not have HP Ice. It'll come up later in the game, but it's just something to keep in mind. So he does go to his Greninja. I'm gonna actually go into my Tapu Koko. The reason I did this is because I thought he would not Hydro Pump. I was somehow like fairly confident that he was either Protean and had Ice Beam, and that he would go for that, or he would not. Like, I was fairly confident he would not go for Hydro Pump if he was Specs Ash. If he was Ash Greninja, he would go for Dark Pulse, and then if he was Protean, he would not have Hydro Pump to take me out, and he would go for Ice Beam. So that's why I go to Tapu Koko right here. He actually goes to his Magearna, and I don't mind this at all. I don't really have a switch into Magearna anyway, so I'm just gonna Nature's Madness as he actually tries to HP Fire, predicting my Ferrothorn, and this damage on Magearna is really great for my Quiverdance Faramosa, which, if you look at his team, can potentially clean sweep. It depends on if whether I take prior damage, whether I can win the speed tie versus his own Faramosa, or whether his Metagross has Bullet Punch, the Greninja has Shuriken, or a combination of both, or whether I'm able to get that set up without taking too much prior damage to be in range of a priority move. So even though my Quiverdance Faramosa most likely cannot sweep, it can definitely pressure Alcanz to just not give me any free room. The other thing to note about this team is that it looks like the Faramosa could very well be Choice Scarf, since I don't have anything faster. I don't have like any like potential Scarfer other than Faramosa that can like help me revenge kill threats. So the Faramosa can very easily kind of bluff the Choice Scarf, and with its ability to switch out moves, that makes it a lot easier for me to pick up an extra kill or something of the sorts and put Alcanz on the back foot. So anyway, I do go for the Nature's Madness as he goes for the HP Fire. I'm just gonna go for the T-Bolt since it'll do more damage than Madness at this point and won't miss. He goes for the Flash Cannon, and I actually live that with 50, with 2%, it is 57.8, and my Mago Berry activates. So I guess this is now a good time to explain. My Tapu Koko set is kind of like a stall breaker set. It helps a lot with stall, but it's quite good in general in that it's really, really bulky. Like you put a ton of investment in HP, and it just bumps up the bulk of Tapu Koko a ton. Like for example, I can reliably switch into Pinsir and not even worry about Earthquake because it won't kill and it'll activate my berry, and that'll just help me regain my health. The berry is also really, really good for beating down stall when you want to like make sure you can still survive seismic tosses and things of the like. And it's basically T-Bolt, Taunt, Nature's Madness, U-turn. So yeah, it can't touch stuff like Lando T. That's one of the downsides of it. But it's a very nice set in general, and even though it's mainly for stall, it can come up to be useful in a ton of situations. So there we see the Flash Cannon. Now right here, I definitely could have U-turn, kept up the offensive momentum and pressure versus Alcanz, but I just go for the safe T-Bolt because I really don't want to U-turn and have him stay in, because that means one of my important mods is going to have to take a big hit or die. So I really wanted to avoid that. Here I go for Landorus. I think this was a bit risky in that he could have HP Iced or possibly even Z moved. Usually Lando doesn't run a Z move with U-turn, it runs SD, but we'll actually see later on in the game. I don't know, we don't see it now, but his Lando doesn't have Rocky Helmet, I think, and we saw from earlier that it most likely doesn't have HP Ice. Now for right here, I realize in retrospect that I shouldn't risk my Lando that much, so that's why I go to my Tentacruel right here as he U-turns. Honestly, with Tentacruel, I was just planning on potentially coming in on an HP Ice and just Hydro Pumping to take out Lando. But he just goes for the U-turn, so I definitely could have HP Ice as Lando there. And again, looking back, he most likely did not have HP Ice. But the reason I switched was just to be extra cautious now that I realize that I need to be more careful around my Faramosa. Now, he does go to Metagross on my tent on my Ferrothorn. On my Tentacruel, sorry. So I'm just gonna go into my Ferrothorn again, as he shows that he is indeed Earthquake, not Hammer Arm. I'm just gonna toss up a Leech Seed so I can keep some health and start chipping down this Metagross. Make sure it's in range of a neutral Bug Buzz, stuff like that, so I may not have to waste my Z move, stuff like that. And he just keeps going for EQ. I'm gonna set up a Spike right here, and this chip helps a lot in really limiting the switch-ins he has with his Mons actually. So right here, he switches out into Landorus, and I actually switch out myself because I was thinking that I really should avoid taking too much damage with Faramosa in order to be careful about. I really should avoid taking too much damage on Ferrothorn so that I'm careful about his Greninja. And I figured that the moment my Ferrothorn goes down, I can bring in my. Moment something goes down, I can grab a kill with Faramosa. So that's why I went to Tapu Koko, kind of like a sack, because again, I don't really feel like I need it. He actually goes into his Lando, I guess, feeling like his Metagross was not going to accomplish much. And so, yeah, he does go to his Lando. I could just, again, like go to my own Lando or to my Dessert here, but I just sack my Koko off and go into my Faramosa, and I'm just going to click Ice Beam and take this out. Now, again, because my team looks like it could very well be Choice Craft. Yeah, there we see it's Yachi Lando, not Z move, but there we see it's not Helmet. But I go for the Ice Beam, take it out, and because my team looks like it's Scarf, he goes into his Metagross, and surprise, I reveal that I'm not Choice Locked. I go for the Bug Buzz, take it out. And now this Faramosa is looking very, very dangerous. He's kind of forced into his own Faramosa, which is what he does. So I'm just gonna go into my Lando. My reasoning here was that if he is Ice Beam, he is not going to get a special attack beast boost. This is something I know based on that U-turn damage on Charizard. So because of that, my Tentacruel will be able to come in right after and Rapid Spin. And in general, Tentacruel will be like. Or I could even just take out the Faramosa. So like I have options with my Tentacruel. So and it won't die, so I can at the very least get off a spin and have my Zard to check his Faramosa. And plus, because he's physical, he may not want to. His Ice Beam won't kill me, I think. I'm pretty sure. So he may just want to HJK. So he does HJK. I get some helmet damage on it. It's taking rocks and spikes, which is going to limit its switch-ins. And I can just go for the U-turn right here, take out the Faramosa. Sorry, take out the Magearna. And I'm just going to go into my Tentacruel right here. Tentacruel is kind of just sack fodder to make him go into one thing so I can go into another thing. If the yeah, basically I don't. Basically, Tentacruel does nothing at this point, so I'm just going to it so he can take it out, and I can respond to whatever he does. So he does go into his Faramosa. This should have been an indication to me. Well, it kind of is an indication to me that his Greninja is most likely not Ash Greninja, because otherwise he'd probably want to get the Beast Boost. That's the one thing I was worried about, is Ash Greninja potentially trying to get the Beast Boost. So that was something to keep in mind. But he does just go to his Faramosa and HJK. I can bring my Lando back, and because of Intimidate, I'll be able to live this next HJK. And I just U-turn to take out the Faramosa. And I'm just gonna go into my Ferrothorn right here. The only way you can kill my Ferrothorn is with HP Fire slash Low Kick or flinching me with Dark Pulse. And he goes to his Greninja and he shows HP Fire. So he shows you he's Protean. And so I was actually, well, I guess here's a little backstory. So this game is pretty much guaranteed over now at this point. But, there's still a possibility that this Greninja is running Water Shuriken or even Shadow Sneak. But I was running kind of low on time, and kind of low on time, and there was a possibility that I might have to get up in the middle of the game to do something else, and I didn't want to time out. So I was trying to click really, really quickly. So I made a mistake here, honestly, a big choke, in that I didn't think about the possibility of Water Shuriken Greninja or even Shadow Sneak. And I kind of like double choked right here, but within like a few seconds, I literally clicked Faramosa, clicked Z Focus Blast, clicked Skip Turn, and there was a dead Greninja, and my Faramosa was at 8%, and I was like, what the heck happened? But this was definitely a really, really major mistake. First thing, I should have gone to Charizard to set up the sun. This way, Water Shuriken would not be able to kill my Faramosa. Secondly, I should have gone for Bug Buzz. Well, one reason to go to Charizard is so that his Greninja's type changes to something that most likely will not resist Bug Buzz. And if he has Shadow Sneak, Bug Buzz will still. He shouldn't be able to take me out. And the life orb damage plus the resisted Bug Buzz damage should still be able to take him out. If he went for Shadow Sneak on a fighting move, I basically lost. So yeah. And if he took me out, got one more hit with that Water Shuriken, which he had a 33% chance to get 4 or 5 hits, then I also would have lost the game. So that was definitely a mistake right there with the end game, that last turn of not going to Charizard and going first to Faramosa. But I managed to not get hit by 4 water shurikens or 5 water shurikens and taken out. So that's lucky for me, but definitely a big mistake to keep in mind, to make sure that you account for all possibilities that the opponent might have in the endgame scenario. I think also the way I played with the Tentacruel in the early game of taking that Volt Switch, just that one turn really made me lose some of my really, really dominating lead. I did have a really good matchup in this game, I think. And I think that taking that Voltage with Tentacruel maybe had been a factor that gave him a little bit of leeway in this game. I guess one thing to consider is that Tentacruel actually completely hardwalls like Ice Beam, Gunk Shot, HP Fire Greninja, completely hardwalled, which is really interesting. I didn't expect that. But yeah. So yeah, that definitely could have kept my Tentacruel healthier, maybe played around his Metagross a little bit better, around his Greninja a little bit better. But I was able to win eventually, so that's good. Definitely also could have utilized Zard more if I just, again, played with my Tentacruel better and just kept up those hazards. Maybe I could have gotten an extra kill and also had my Zard in at the time to just really ramp up the pressure against him. But it was a fairly good game overall, and definitely one that demonstrates to make sure you account for all possibilities and really, really plan for the end game with like a split that Tentacruel anyway. But yeah, that's the game. Hope you guys enjoyed and learned something, and I'll see you guys later.